Of the three coalitions, if you would ask me which one of the three have come out as the big winner, I would say the Antwerp Declaration.
It's really important that the European Parliament, they use their powers to prevent a weakening of social and environmental standards.
You're listening to EU Watchdog Radio.
Hi, welcome to a whole new episode of EU Watchdog Radio. I'm Joana Louçã, comms officer at Corporate Europe Observatory. And today I'll be talking to my colleagues Kenneth Haar and Olivier Hoedeman about what we already know of the plans the European Commission has for the coming 5 years. I know the topic sounds dry, and we will have to use words that are even drier, such as double deregulation, competitiveness checks, rule of law, and my personal favorite, the omnibus law. But despite this apparent dryness, it is important. And if you want to read about it, check out our long article called Competitiveness, Inside the Troubling Corporate Blueprint for the Coming Commission. Let's zoom out for a second and consider an hypothetical worker from Carraseda de Anciães, a small town in the northeast of Portugal. Let's call her Maria. Maria gets sent by her company to work in Silly, Valonia, in Belgium. Maria is happy. The prospect of a change of scenery and the Belgian working contract are somewhat appeasing and might even diminish the saudades she will feel from being in such a different country. However, she is then informed that her contract will remain the same, her salary will remain the same, her benefits, or lack thereof, will remain the same. Maria is now feeling silly. She is no longer happy. And even though she is fictional, neither are we. This is an example of what something called the Posted Workers Directive would look like in practice. So, despite the dryness that these issues can have, they have a very, very clear effect on our lives. And it is part of the downward spiral in social standards that are in immediate risk. But this social dumping is not the only challenge ahead. The same applies to environmental protection, for example. But I've kept you long enough. Let's go to Kenneth Haar, who analyzed the political guidelines von der Leyen announced for the next 5 years of the European Commission. Let's start by talking about what is not in the document.
First is when we had the guidelines 5 years ago, so with the first commission under von der Leyen, it was guidelines that focused a lot on climate change. Back then, she announced a series of initiatives on climate, and it would be a mistake to say that it's been 5 years of success on climate policies. Lots of defeats and lots of half-baked measures. But what we're looking at now is practically zero initiatives on climate change, except for one big topic, and that's about clean technologies, where the Commission say they intend to take a series of measures to help industry in general, energy-intensive industries in particular, help them go through a transition to a more cleaner way of production. I think that should be taken with a big grain of salt, in that we've seen for many years technologies being portrayed as very clean that in the end are not really. So a long story short, on climate, it's a small disaster. And we're talking about the 5 years that will take us to 2030, which was always supposed to be a crucial phase in the fight against the disastrous climate change. And I think there's a very real risk that the European Union will go almost into reverse. Last point on social and labor issues, it's practically empty. It's full of vague statements about doing better for workers and for the poorer segments of society, but it's very vague. It's not very concrete, and on that point, it's even much less ambitious than what we saw 5 years ago. So, I mean, for us in CEO, what we see is the results of a long time of very intense corporate lobbying to influence the next 5 years in the European Union.
And Kenneth went through the guidelines and compared them with the demands from three separate business groups to see who actually put the biggest fingerprint on the text. The first group is European Roundtable, a club for the CEOs of some of the biggest companies in Europe.
They are regarded by the president of the Commission, so von der Leyen, as advisors that can step in when something very important comes up. They are equally powerful today as they were when they were formed back in the 80s. And this time around, a lot of the proposals on competitiveness come mainly from the European Roundtable.
Influencer number two is the Employers Association Business Europe, whose particular obsession is the single market, especially what they refer to as gold plating, which happens when a member state implements a law that goes a bit further than EU law.
Gold plating has become a slogan that is used against almost any kind of regulation in member states that is more ambitious than what is required by EU law. And it's measures against climate change, it's measures to protect the environment that come under fire.
Finally, the most effective group was a coalition called the Antwerp Declaration that joins the companies that more aggressively attacked EU climate policies, in particular since mid-2022. It's spearheaded by the energy-intensive industries, such as chemicals, paper, steel, cement, and the like. And their agenda is clearly to fight back any regulatory measures that would force them into producing in a more sustainable manner.
In early February, those companies gathered at a meeting in Antwerp and drew up a list of 10 demands that they would push with the European Commission and with the Council. If you look at the guidelines, as far as I can tell, of those 10 demands, only one of them has not been fulfilled yet.
And the one that was not fulfilled, by the way, is to have an industrial deal commissioner, which in many ways is rather a symbolic thing.
So of the three coalitions, if you would ask me which one of the three have come out as the big victor, the big winner, I would say the Antwerp Declaration. I think if we went back 5 years, if someone told us that the energy-intensive industries would take charge of EU climate policies, we will probably think that would be overstated and unrealistic. They've been a stone in the shoe of European initiatives for a very, very long time, for decades. They've been handed over big subsidies in the form of free quotas under the emissions trading scheme and what have we. But they're opposition to concrete, enforceable, effective climate policies has never been appeased at all.
We at CEO organized a webinar on all of these issues with a lot of NGOs and trade unions represented. The discussion zoomed in on what my colleague Olivier Hoedeman refers to as a double deregulation push by the EU institutions. And it's double because it is happening not only on the EU level, but also on the national level. Here's Olivier.
EU level deregulation, which is in the form of so-called better regulation, all kind of impact assessments and competitiveness checks and all kind of procedures to scrutinize new legislation and weaken it, basically, based on this idea that regulation is bad for business and competitiveness. And then the other dimension of this double deregulation push is national level laws. And there it's the single market enforcement framework that's used. So there will be new initiatives in that field that basically could weaken or limit the space that governments have to introduce new progressive legislation.
On the EU level, this obsession with competitiveness was certainly present in the political guidelines presented by von der Leyen.
It's not a very detailed document, so I mean, it's I would say, though, that one part that has taken first place is about the competitiveness of European businesses, which is not a new theme in the European Union. It's been a recurring theme for the past 25 years. I would say, though, that this time around, it does take the first prize. So that's a key word that you will see repeated practically on each and every page.
One of the examples of this deregulation agenda on the EU level regarding new legislation is particularly worrisome.
One of the things that was highlighted as something new and very problematic was that von der Leyen proposes that the other EU institutions, including the European Parliament, that they should also start doing the same kind of impact assessments as the Commission does. So that would mean looking at all amendments agreed in the European Parliament and assessing how they impact competitiveness of industry. That would be something totally unprecedented. And of course, something that would really be a major obstacle for the Parliament's improving proposed EU legislation from the perspective of people and the environment.
Another side to this that would impact not new legislation, but all, and you heard me right, really all EU legislation, is something called the omnibus law, one of the complicated words I mentioned at the beginning of the episode. And if you are wondering where it comes from, the answer is easy.
The omnibus law is a proposal that actually it's the number one proposal from the Antwerp Declaration. It's a kind of an old theme of CEO because it was first tabled by the European Roundtable 12 years ago. This is what it's about. It's about going through the whole EU acquis, all European laws, and check them for their effect on competitiveness. The next step, obviously, would then be to change them all or neutralize them in some way. It was tabled in the debate on the next term in February with the Antwerp Declaration, and it very quickly became a big issue. It was supported by the French and the Italian and the German government shortly after, which is a first. You would normally not see the French and the German government support radical proposals like that. But this time around, they did. That was a big step back because, I mean, the first time it was tabled by the ERT 12 years ago, it was not really taken seriously by anyone. At least at this stage, it looks as if there is a real risk that the proposal for an omnibus law will materialize at some level. We don't know to what extent or when or how radical it will be, but it's in there. It's potentially a very drastic measure because it means that business interests will be favored over other interests in society. So we will see a more single-minded commission in the coming 5 years.
On the national level, we can go back to what Kenneth explained to be a demand of the Employers Association Business Europe. Whenever a country has more progressive legislation than EU law, what they refer to as gold plating. For example, France, as a means to mitigate CO2 emissions, tried to ban short-distance flights when there were train alternatives. The airport lobby did not receive this well and complained to the European Commission that the ban violated, and I quote, the freedom to provide services, and therefore was infringing on the single market legislation. And this is one of many, many examples.
When governments introduce new laws or new policies, and industry thinks that they're harming the single market and their possibilities to do business, they can complain to the European Commission, and the Commission will then investigate if that law or policy is allowed or not. Mm-hmm. And in practice, it's interpretations of EU law, so sparked by these complaints by industry and often by parts of the Commission that are very neoliberal. It's ideology-based, so it's not really... I wouldn't call it a strictly legal assessment. It's quite political.
Still, businesses are complaining that the investigations take too long or that governments then don't fully comply.
So now the Commission is proposing that all of this enforcement stuff around single market should be put in under the rule of law procedures. Mm-hmm. And that would give it a whole different type of sanction possibilities. So that rule of law is so far used in attempts to avoid undermining of democracy in Hungary and Poland. Mm-hmm. And that makes a lot of sense. But then these type of challenges to national level legislation, very often environmental or social protection, I mean, that's not something that should be moved into the rule of law procedures. But that's on the table too. So those are just a couple of examples of that they're really trying to move the yardsticks very far.
We are almost at the end of this episode. And to finish off, as for future steps, Olivier described the conclusions from the webinar as three different branches. The first one is the concrete actions that MEPs can now take.
It's really important that the European Parliament becomes aware of these dangers and that they use their powers to prevent a weakening of social and environmental standards. And that is something that they should do in the next weeks and months. When all the candidate commissioners come to the parliament and they go through this approval hearing, and that's where MEPs should really stand up for the public interest and grill the candidate commissioners on how they will safeguard social and environmental standards. It's crucial to look at really specific examples of legislation that will be targeted. We need that because, of course, deregulation sounds very abstract, and all of this sounds very technocratic and bureaucratic and far away. But if you zoom in on what is really at stake, and you can give some examples of what's at stake for ordinary people, then it becomes real. And for example, there's talk of simplification of reach of the chemicals legislation. Now, that is about toxic chemicals that impact our health in the workplace, in our daily lives. So that's an example.
Lastly, the hegemonic narrative around regulation should definitely be contested.
In the last few years, both from business lobby groups and from right-wing and far-right political forces, regulation has been framed as something that's burdensome, that's costly, that's useless, that's holding us back, whether it's farmers or it's small businesses. So that whole discourse has become very strong and probably has impacted the thinking of many people. And of course, that thinking is largely wrong. I mean, anyone would be against senseless bureaucracy, but these regulations are basically protections for all of us against toxic chemicals and so on. So it's really important to develop a strong counter frame, a positive frame around regulation. And that's where we have some work to do, to develop the right frame and to then popularize it.
And that's a wrap for today's episode. I'm Chiara from Counterbalance, and I want to thank you for joining this conversation on EU Watchdog Radio. If you enjoyed it, be sure to share it far and wide with your network. Also, do not forget to follow Corporate Europe Observatory on social media to stay updated on their work exposing how corporate influence over EU decision-making fuels today's crisis. Thanks again, and see you next time!